Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining static routing over an MPLS-TE topology. I love simplifying complex telecom and networking concepts into clear, easy-to-understand explanations. My goal is to make learning these topics as straightforward as possible, just the way I wish I had been taught when I was starting out. If you find this helpful, be sure to like the video, subscribe to the channel, and hit the bell icon so you never miss an update. In the last few videos, we talked about the various components of MPLS-TE, and we've gradually shown how to configure each of these to create a working MPLS-TE topology. We configured and verified the OSPF underlay, and we deployed RSVP-TE to create the LSP tunnels. We took a look at how the OSPF underlay operates, and we also looked in detail at how RSVP-TE performs its function. After all of this, we now have a working MPLS-TE topology with our OSPF-TE underlay and our RSVP-TE mechanisms in place, and we have our LSP tunnel up and running. Now what? Well, we have to start routing traffic down our tunnel. Remember, once the LSP tunnel is up, it doesn't do anything unless we configure the topology to route traffic down it, just like any other physical or tunnel interface. There are several options we can use to route the traffic. Some are more conventional, while others are more specific to MPLS-TE. In this video, we'll examine the case of static routing. Now, it may sound simple, and indeed it is, but there are a few interesting things we should keep in mind whenever we implement something like this. So we go back to our topology, and we have all of the various components already configured, as we have already stated. But there's one more thing that we have to do that we haven't done so far in the previous videos, and that's to include the configuration of the customer edge routers. Now, there are a variety of ways that we can interconnect our CEs to the MPLS network, and we've seen several of these in the videos that cover MPLS in general. But for now, we'll just use a simple OSPF adjacency with their corresponding PE routers. So for the CE1 and PE1 routers, we have the following OSPF configurations. These are normal OSPF configurations that create a simple OSPF adjacency between these two routers. Similarly, for CE2 and PE2, we have these configurations. So now the customer networks are known to the PE1 and PE2 routers via OSPF. Now let's say we want to reach our CE2 router loopback, which represents the customer network behind that router, from PE1, but we want to use the already established LSP. How would we achieve that? We would need to create a static route. But before we do, let's take a look at our tunnel configuration to remember what we had configured. On PE1, we have the following configuration. Now, these commands were used to establish the LSP tunnel. For our purposes of routing, we need to know this here, the tunnel number, so that we can statically route traffic out of that interface. Also make note of this command, the IP unnumbered loopback 0 command. This simply tells the router that we have no specific IP address assigned to the tunnel interface, but it should simply adopt the IP address of the loopback 0 interface. Now just keep that in mind and you'll see why shortly. So now we're ready to statically route traffic from PE1 to the loopback of CE2, we can apply this static routing command. That's it. It's a simple static route with an exit interface of the specific tunnel. Once you have the underlying infrastructure, that's all you need. However, we must remember that LSP tunnels are unidirectional, which means that this tunnel will only deal with traffic going to that destination. We haven't provisioned an LSP tunnel for the return traffic. But as it stands, will a ping from PE1 to the loopback of CE2 work? Well, let's see. It does indeed. Why? Because when we send a ping from PE1 to the 192.168.12.1 destination, the source IP address is that of the tunnel endpoint. And because of that unnumbered command that we saw before, the address that is used is that of loopback 0. Now on the outgoing ping, the static root command caused the packet to take the tunnel. Once it reaches CE2, the return traffic has no tunnel provisioned, but CE2 does participate in regular OSPF, at least that's how we've configured it. So it's routed back using regular OSPF. Now, if we wanted to create an LSP tunnel for the return journey, we would have to configure another LSP tunnel at PE2, which would act as the head-end router for that tunnel. And it would have to be created towards the tail-end router, which is PE1. But we won't do that now. Let's now take a look at the result of this ping that we routed down our tunnel. First, let's examine the tunnel interface to confirm that we did indeed route traffic via our LSP tunnel. Here we can see that the tunnel has sent 5 packets, which are our 5 pings that we sent out. So the tunnel was indeed used. Next, let's look at PE1's routing table. Here you can see the specific route is routed through our LSP tunnel. So far, so good. Let's take a look at our MPLS forwarding table on PE1. Here we see many different labels that are being shared, but the most important thing to notice is the 192.168.12.0/24 destination. You can see that it has a T there that indicates that for that destination, there is forwarding taking place through an LSP tunnel. You can also see the outgoing tunnel interface as well as a next hop indicator of point to point. You can also see pop label here, because since we're going directly from one PE router to another, we have penultimate hop popping taking place. We can get some more detail about our specific routing using the following command. Here we can see some of the same information, but in addition to this, we see more details. This information here contains the label stack and encapsulation details. Specifically, it tells us that we have a MAC header or an Ethernet header size of 14 bytes and an encapsulation overhead of 18 bytes, which is the MPLS header. Next, we have the MRU, which is the maximum receive unit. Now, in this context, this is similar to the MTU, or the maximum transmission unit. And it's essentially the packet size limit. And here we also see the underlying physical exit interface of gigabit 02. Finally, we have some more information about the encapsulation, and this is shown here using these values. This is essentially broken down into the following sections. We have this, the destination MAC address, then we have the source MAC address, and we have the MPLS ether type, and this number here indicates that this packet actually carries an MPLS label. Finally, the no output feature configured text here indicates that there's no additional forwarding policies, such as QoS, filtering, or policing that are applied to packets matching this entry through the LSP tunnel. So that, in a nutshell, is routing traffic through an LSP tunnel on an MPLS-TE topology using static routing. Now keep in mind that such static routing is not scalable, as you can imagine. So static routing should only be deployed on small networks where scalability is not a requirement, or as quick fixes that are to be rectified as soon as possible. There are other more appropriate routing solutions for MPLS-TE, which we'll talk about in the next few videos. For now, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to leave a comment. I'm always happy to read them and to respond. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.